If you're currently in the United States on a work visa and you've recently been laid off or furloughed, or you're at risk of being laid off or furloughed, make sure you watch this video to find out all of the information that you need to know regarding your lawful status and presence in the United States. Hello everyone and welcome back to another video. If this is your first time watching one of my videos, my name is Stephanie D'Angelo. I am the founder of D'Angelo Law PLLC, an immigration law firm based in South Florida. Due to COVID-19 and the high unemployment rate, I thought it was very important to make this video for those of you that are in the United States on work visas and are either at risk of losing your employment or you have already lost your employment. I wanted to give you the information that you need to know regarding your status as well as any potential options that you may have. Many of you know about the grace period that is given to non-immigrants when they lose their status and or employment. If you're terminated or laid off, you typically get a 60-day grace period. However, if you quit your employment, you don't get that 60-day grace period. Due to the pandemic, there's been a lot of support regarding requesting that 60-day grace period to be extended to 90 days. Once you lose your non-immigrant status and the applicable grace period passes, you begin to start accruing unlawful presence. If you accrue more than 180 days of unlawful presence, but less than a year, you are inadmissible to the United States for a period of 3 years. So if you depart the United States, you can't come back in for 3 years. You are not eligible to adjust status in the United States. So if you've accrued more than 180 days of unlawful presence, then you're inadmissible and barred from the United States for 3 years. If you accrue more than a year, more than 12 months of unlawful presence, then you are inadmissible and barred for 10 years. Now, I'm sure your next question is, what happens if you're unlawful for less than 180 days? Well, you're not officially inadmissible and you're not formally barred from the United States, but it is still bad. Because if you accrued unlawful presence past the termination of your visa, the expiration date of your I-94, the next time you apply for an immigration benefit, whether you're going out and coming back in on a new visa, or you're applying from within the United States, the officer at the port of entry has the discretion to prohibit your entry. They can decide to not let you in. Even if you have a valid visa, they can see that you were illegal in the United States for a period of time, you've accrued unlawful presence, even though it was under 180 days, they can decide to not let you in. USCIS could decide not to give you immigration benefits or relief because of your prior accrual of unlawful presence. So any unlawful presence essentially is bad. Even if it's not the full 180 days to bar you for 3 years, it's still not good to accrue any unlawful presence in the United States because that could definitely affect you in the future the next time you apply for something or try to come back into the United States. With any non-immigrant visa, your lawful status in the United States can terminate for a number of reasons. If it's a work visa, your status will terminate at the end of your I-94 date. Your physical visa is just for traveling. It just tells you when you can travel using that visa. So the expiration date on your visa only dictates how long you can use that visa for. Sometimes your expiration date on your visa is a different date than the validity period of your petition. It's a different date of your I-94 expiration date because that visa expiration date is strictly for that physical visa. You'll notice that if you have a visitor's visa, sometimes visitor's visas are valid for a period of 10 years, but that doesn't mean you can come to the United States and stay here on a visitor's visa for 10 years. The longest you could stay is 6 months at a time. The expiration date on your visa only dictates how long you can use that particular visa to travel, to come back into the United States. What controls your lawful status in the United States is your I-94 expiration date or the validity period given on your particular petition. If you have an employment-based non-immigrant petition, such as an L-1 or an E-2 or an H-1B, the validity period on your I-797 notice of action dictates how long your status is. Also the I-94. With that being said, sometimes your status will end before that validity period date or before your I-94 expiration date. How? If it's based on employment, your employment stops. So let's say you're no longer working for your company, you're terminated, you're laid off. Even though your I-94 expires later, because your employment has stopped today, Today is when your status is no longer valid. Now, this is aside from the grace period, of course, but because your employment has stopped, the basis for your non-immigrant petition, that I-94 expiration date no longer matters. The fact is your status has ended as of the date that you were no longer working for your employer. If you are here on a work visa, you must be full-time and actively employed with that employer that sponsored your work visa. With respect to being furloughed, even though you're technically still an employee of the company, it does violate the terms of your visa, the terms of your status, because it's not full-time employment. If you self-sponsored your own visa, for example, an E2 visa, you're the investor in your own company, this still applies to you because as part of the E2 requirement, your investment must be in a business that is operating. So if your business is no longer operating, then you no longer have a valid E2 visa and you no longer have lawful status in the United States. So your business must continue to operate in order for your visa to be valid. So E2 treaty investors, this also applies to you. So essentially, if you have been laid off or furloughed, or you're going to be laid off or furloughed and you're here on a work visa, then the grace period remains at 60 days. So if this is your case, unfortunately, you have to leave the United States within that grace period, or you have to obtain new employment and meet the requirements for obtaining a new work visa. So let's say you were on H-1B with one employer and you were laid off, you must find a new employer willing to sponsor a change of employer H-1B petition for you and have that filed within the 60-day grace period. Or you have to file another application to salvage your status, whether it's a change of status within the United States or file for a green card and an adjustment of status to maintain your lawful presence in the United States. Financially speaking, keep in mind the public charge rule. With respect to the stimulus money, if you're eligible to receive the payment, you are able to accept it. You're not required to give it back. It's not considered a public benefit that would make you a public charge. It is considered a tax credit, so you don't have to worry about accepting the stimulus money if you do receive it. As for unemployment, I did make another video with respect to the public charge rule and applying for unemployment benefits. I will link it right here if you want to check that out. If you're on the YouTube app or on the YouTube website, it'll pop up right here and you can click on that. I'll also put it in the description down below. But basically, unemployment is an earned benefit, so you also can obtain unemployment benefits without it subjecting you to the public charge rule, because it is considered an earned benefit. If you've been working in the United States and filing your taxes and contributing to that, then you are eligible to obtain unemployment benefits given you qualify within your respective state's application process. Here's one thing I do want to point out with unemployment. Each state has their own eligibility requirements and their rules, and typically you must be able to work. If you're here on a work visa and your employment stopped with the employer that sponsored your work visa and you don't have an independent employment authorization document, then you're not able to work and you're not eligible to obtain unemployment benefits because you can't meet that requirement. You might be willing to work, but you're not able. Now, some states have relaxed that requirement due to COVID-19 pandemic, so obviously check with your respective state and their eligibility requirements, but the answer would be no to that question. You're not able to work because you're not allowed. That might inhibit you from obtaining unemployment, even if you have been here for years, paying taxes, contributing, technically should be receiving unemployment if you are laid off. But once again, it depends on the state in which you're in. If they've relaxed that requirement, then you might be eligible to obtain unemployment. I also want to mention something very, very important. A lot of companies, what they do when they are laying off one of their employees that are here on a work visa, is that they automatically file or instruct the employee to file an I-539 change of non-immigrant status to a visitor. Either the employer does it for you, their attorneys do it for you, or they tell you to file it yourself. That way, within that 60-day grace period, you have an application filed to change your status from whatever your visa category is. You file to change it to a visitor. That way it can lock in your lawful presence and you don't accrue unlawful presence. That's typically the strategy. But I do want to let everyone know, I let all of my clients know this, this is very important. Each time you submit an application to USCIS, you are telling them something. okay? It's an affirmative action, it's an overt act, you are telling them something. If you are filing a change of status to a visitor status to a B2, you are telling them that your intention is to remain here temporarily, okay? To be here as a non-immigrant and then return to your home country. Part of the change of status, you might be saying, I was recently laid off, I need more time to get everything in order. Because of the pandemic, I'm unable to travel and depart the United States within 60 days, so I'm filing this change of status to buy myself more time, an additional 6 months, for example. The second you submit it, that's what you are telling the United States your intention is. If you do anything that contradicts that intention, then you are in trouble. It's okay if you file a new non-immigrant petition after you file the change to the visitor status. It's okay because you maintain your non-immigrant intent. What's not okay is after you filed that change to a visitor, you file for a green card shortly thereafter. Because on one hand, you're saying my intention is to maintain a non-immigrant status and to depart the United States. I just need extra time to leave. And then on the other hand, it's like, no, I want to stay permanently. I want a green card. There's the contradiction. That is not good. Keep in mind, if you are filing within that 60-day grace period or any time, if you are filing an extension or a change or an application to change your status to a visitor, there is a presumption that that is your intention and you can't change your intention within 90 days. This is very, very bad. There's a presumption of fraud and this can really, really cause an issue for you in the future. I'm not going to get into all of the details. You should consult with an attorney definitely regarding that information. But just so you know, keep in mind that filing that change of status to a visitor, once you've been laid off, once you've been furloughed, it can help by buying you more time with respect to lawful presence to the United States, but it could also hurt your chances for a green card if that is your ultimate next plan. There are a lot of people that can self-petition for permanent residency through, for example, EB1 or EB2. So those of you, keep that in mind. If you're getting laid off with your employer, it will hurt your chances to file an immigrant petition within that grace period. If you've already filed or your company has filed an I-539 application to change status on your behalf. I hope this video was helpful to you in determining what the next step is or what you should do regarding your lawful status in the United States. Please go ahead and give it a thumbs up to let me know that it was helpful and that I should continue to do more videos like this. Also, leave a comment down below if you have any questions. If you look in the comments for all my other videos, you'll notice that I do respond to everyone. So go ahead and leave a comment if you have a question or if you just want to say hi and let me know where you're watching from. Also, if you want to be notified the next time I upload a new video, make sure you're subscribed and turn your post notifications on by hitting that bell button. Thank you for watching and I'll see you in the next video.